which means there can be joy in our house. So we thank you today for this day, God, for this opportunity, God, to come here, God, to be in this atmosphere, God, to be able to give you praise and honor and glory for all that you have done. Your word says, God, that you are the King of kings, that you are the Lord of lords. The word says you're the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending, the first and the last. There is none other beside you. And so, God, we praise and thank you today. We thank you, God, for this service, God, for this time, God, this opportunity to be here, God, to worship and to honor you, God. So we thank you for this service, God. We thank you for 9 years. We thank you for 9 years. God, we thank you for 9 years. We thank you for 9 years. God, we thank you for 9 years. God, we thank you for 9 years. God, we praise you today. God, it's only by your grace and your mercy that we're here. God, so we magnify your name, God. We thank you for this celebration service, God. But not only for this service here, we pray for churches that are open all over the world in the name of Jesus, lifting up the name of Jesus. We thank you for people being healed, saved, delivered, and set free by the power of an almighty God, the one and only God. So we just magnify you today. We give you the praise, we give you the glory and the honor. And we ask these things in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you today.
Good morning, Faith family. Come on. Good morning, Faith family. My name is Kim, and I am here to give you your welcome this morning. We appreciate everybody who's in the seats this morning. Anybody who's joining us online, we truly appreciate you joining us. Few things this morning. I gotta find out where I'm at. We asked that if you, we would like to stay connected with you guys. So anybody online, if you could just type in stay connected and we can get somebody to get in touch with you. Anybody who is in the service, we do have some forms in the back that if you could fill those out and give them to one of our church members, our greeters, we would like to stay in contact with you. I'd like to share our mission for growing faith. So if everybody will read it with me. We are leading people searching for more into a thriving relationship with Jesus. Right on. Because we know anything that is growing, that is thriving, is healthy, and we want to help you get there. Couple of announcements that we have. First of all, we would like to extend a special invitation for you to refer to the Growing Faith text line for all the announcements or visit the Growing Faith website. One announcement that I do have tonight is that the return of small groups this Wednesday with that's what I've been waiting for. with our men and women's group studying through the five love languages. There's something else that I would like to address hopefully quickly this morning. Cindy gave me a few extra minutes to be here in front of you this morning. Let me paint a picture for you. You have been in foster care your entire life. You turn 18, you're turned out. It's here it is. Here's the world. Go fend for yourself. Usually with little to nothing except the clothes on your back. And maybe some savings if you've had a job since you were 16. Think about losing a partner, losing your spouse, and you now being the sole person to care for your house, to care for your children, to bring in your income. Circumstances beyond your control that put you into a situation where you can no longer provide for yourself. You've heard Pastor T talk about the care portal. Growing faith is a part of that. For those of you who have been here a while, you know about our Do Something Sunday. For those of you who are new, for those of you who are joining us online and you don't know about Do Something Sunday, this is what we do. Usually we have a calendar. It has not been set this year, but we will pick a theme for the month. So say, this is March. You know what? Let's go into baby needs. We've got new babies here. What if you were a single mom of a new baby and you couldn't buy diapers and you couldn't buy toys and you couldn't buy clothes? That's where Growing Faith is going to step in to help you. So what we need, family, you should have all received a flyer when you walked in. We did inventory in what we have in our back room for our Do Something Sundays. We are so lacking. Family, we are lacking the most basic needs. Toothbrushes, toothpaste, shampoos and conditioners, hygienes. We have no diapers. What if you have an elderly parent that you're caring for and you need those protective undergarments? Or you have, again, a newborn baby with no diapers, no wipes. What if you've got a teen that has no sanitary protection? Growing Faith needs to provide that. So I have stepped into the role. of being our Do Something Sunday ambassador. When we did inventory last Wednesday, since then, I have just had this burden on my heart that I'm just not doing enough. And God said, you know what? You're a giver. You're a doer. So do something. So I, with Miss Joanna and Miss Janice, going through our inventory, we've started to get things back together. But we need your help, family. So on this flyer, there are just the basic needs that we could give to just any household that's starting up or needs our help. These are the things we'd like to start with, but this is not the end. Every month we will have a different giving theme. So let's start with the basics to just try to get our inventory back up. Pastor T gets requests all the time for the basic things. I couldn't find you a roll of toilet paper back there if we needed to get it for someone. These are the basic things we need. If you can't go and shop, don't have the time to shop, what I'm asking is, if you make a donation on any one of our platforms to Do Something Sunday, in the tagline, if you would just put DSS, we will make sure that those funds go to our Do Something Sunday. This is our initiative, you guys. There is entirely too many people in need out there, and I want to make sure that we've got a few less.
Thank you, Miss Kim. Amen. And on that note, we're moving to talking about our giving. Thank you for the setup, Miss Kim. You know, there's five ways to give here at Growing Faith. Also, we sent out a text message that you should receive on those ways to give. And I just want to share about giving. Just say this word with me, investment. Investment. Everybody say it. Investment. 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 Remember that word, investment. In Luke 8, you had Jesus get invited to a Pharisee's house. When he gets there to eat, the word says a sinful, immoral woman shows up. And she begins to cry on Jesus' feet. She does a perfume, and she dries his feet with her hair. And she gets looked down upon. I'm just paraphrasing the story to get to my main point. She gets looked down upon, and Jesus talks about the one who was forgiven much loves much. He goes to that parable. The one who is forgiven much loves much. And then he goes in chapter 8 in Luke. And it says, soon afterward, Jesus began a tour of the nearby towns and villages. This is Luke chapter 8, verse 1. Preaching and anointing the good news, announcing the good news about the kingdom of God, he took his 12 disciples with him, along with him some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Among them were Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out seven demons. She had seven. That's a lot. I mean, one's enough. But seven. She has seven. Need y'all to, you know what we call it nowadays? Multiple personality disorder. She has seven demons. He said Jesus cured her. He cast out seven demons. Joanna, the wife of Chuzah, Herod's business manager, Susanna, and many others who were contributing from their own resources to support Jesus and his disciples. The reason I said the word invest, because here are people who have been directly affected by Jesus' ministry. Like, they've experienced the freedom of the gospel. They've experienced the power of Christ in their lives. And so instead of keeping it to themselves, they say, you know what? We want to support what Jesus and the disciples are doing. Because it wasn't just so much about themselves. It's about, man, I want them to help and free other people. People that I can't reach, people that I can't get to. And so my question is a challenging question. How much are we investing in the kingdom of God? Because God has invested in us. Can I be honest with you? With no return. Ooh, I'm sorry. I'm just being honest. So the only thing we can give God is faith and obedience. That's all we have to offer. We don't have the amount of money to give faith and obedience. Because he's invested in us. He's invested. How do we know? His son. And so these group of people, and I can imagine being Mary Magdalene. Who knows how long she was dealing with these, just terrifying her, these evil spirits. It doesn't say how long she was, but it just says she had seven demons. And I love when God shows up, it's not a Terry service. He doesn't take 3 or 4 days to cast. He just walks in and, all right, get out. And imagine she comes to herself, I've been freed. I don't really, what could I really give to, you know what? I know it's some people like me who bound just like me. And maybe the best thing I can do is support what Jesus and they're doing, because they're going to go from town to town. And I can't go everywhere with Jesus, but maybe I can send something along to help them, to help somebody who's just like me. Invest. And so we talk about giving. Thank you, Ms. Campbell. So things that we can do, people who need basic needs. Like, let's be honest, I mean, it takes money. It takes money to run your house, right? Amen? I mean, it ain't run just off love and hugs. It takes money. And can be honest, would we like a lot more money to run our house? Well, y'all can be all cute right here. Right here. And so it takes money. What we don't want to do at Growing Faith Tea, we all talk about it, and a lot of times it was a challenge to even preach about money over this past year, because we've swung so far to one side about money to where people are like, you know what, I don't really trust what y'all doing. Then we went to the other side where we don't even challenge people to give. So we're trying to sit right in the middle to give you a biblical perspective on God about just giving to the kingdom of God. And you're right, God himself doesn't need our money. He's self-sufficient. But it does take money to run things on this earth. Amen? And so just not, you know, just as the word says, be a cheerful giver, whatever God placed in your heart. You know, if you I ain't got money, but I got an extra thing of toilet tissue I can bring to the church. You know, I got some extra toothbrush, toothpaste I don't really use, you know, that I can bring to the church. There's ways to give. There's multiple ways to give. So don't just be bound by money. Yes, we need money. We're praying for God just to bless people. Put on your heart to give. But just being a giver to invest in the kingdom. Amen? Amen. 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 All right, we're going to do something a little different today, because this is 9 years. Make notes for 9 years for Growing Faith. So we want to give the opportunity that if anyone want to share how Growing Faith has blessed you. Okay, and I'm going to use the funeral rules. You only got 2 minutes. You only got 2 minutes to share. But just share how Growing Faith has been a blessing to you or to your family since you've been a part of Growing Faith. We're going to leave the door open not long for that. If anybody wants to share. Come on, Brother Darrell. Need some tissue? Want me? Let me get tissue.
Good morning. I'm just really happy to be in the house of the Lord with Growing Faith Fellowship here. Like I've told before, I've said before that Growing Faith and I connected at a tough time in my life and whatnot. And the way that the love that's in this room here, everybody is attached to Growing Faith, is tremendous. The way it's impacted my life, you know, my wife and I are growing together in this community right here. But she mentioned to me many times that God is doing something special in our marriage that will flow into our families, our friends, and the people that we come into contact with and touch. So just to see God working through our life, you know, through the financial ministry, through, you know, the relationships with, you know, Pastor Mike and his family and everybody in the church family. But it's just a blessing to see when you can. It's so many reasons to get discouraged in the world. You know, every time it seems like things are going good, then something else come up where you got to spend some money. And, you know, but at the end of the day, when you look back at it, God is still providing, because we have not missed a meal. No lights been cut off, you know, roof still over your head. So, you know, I'm just thankful. And then, like, you know, I got my niece here. You know, it's good, always good to see my niece here with us. So just how he can use each and every one of us for something. And it's been magnified through being connected to Growing Faith Fellowship, that he can use each and every one of us to bring out something good in somebody. So just keep on, you know, modeling yourself, mirroring yourself like Christ, so that when we step out, we can impact and touch somebody. But like I say, it helps to be in a good community like Growing Faith Fellowship.
Oh, well, come on in. Go ahead.
Everyone knows me. I'm a woman of little words. So I've been with Growing Faith, I guess, the last 7 months. And what's been important to me is just the transparency. So I'm growing little by little, inch by inch. But I have enjoyed being part of the women ministry with Cindy. Miss Cindy, Pastor T, Miss Marsha, the prayers. And so I'm just thankful for the great transparency that I received with the church.
Amen. All right. Well, come on now. Come on down.
All right. Praise God. So I'm thankful just, you know, I when I came to Growing Faith, I came from a good Bible teaching church, so it wasn't that I felt a lack, so to speak, but when God brought Daryl and I together, Growing Faith was a part of it. And so as I got into Growing Faith, I started to see the value in being a part of this community. And being a part of the community has been important because I'm on a walk that I cannot do by myself. And that is in every aspect of what that looks like, you know, breaking a part of me. And so pride has a way of stepping in anyone's situation, especially when you're independent and you're by yourself. I bring a lot to the table. This is I. And to break that down to we, it took Growing Faith to be able to do that for me. That's from a community perspective, having Miss Marsha, Cindy, Pastor Mike, Pastor T, and other members of the church without naming. It really takes a community. And a lot of times where you feel like you're strong, God will show you, you can't do it by yourself. And it really took, you know, and I continue to, and I think that to speak to Luana's point, the brave transparency, even though I feel like I'm strong in a lot of areas, it's God still showed me that you need to depend on me through the Growing Faith Fellowship community. And so he's given me the platform to do that in this church family, and I am so thankful to be a part of Growing Faith, even at this level. I'm super excited about it. I'm glad to where I see God has taken one, the obedience that it's really been difficult for me, but the obedience in itself has proven to me that God is more than capable of handling any situation I have in my life for my good. And so I'm thankful for that, and that's want to just thank Pastor T and Cindy just for the love you guys have for God first, which sprinkled down into the love you have for me and my family. So thank you so much.
All right, well, come on down. Come on down.
Good morning, family. So a little story about myself. I started off or grew up in a traditional Baptist church, being very active, drill team, praise dance team, junior choir, mass choir, everything. Then I went into a rebellious phase, like as in my journey as a believer. Then I went into, and I'm going to add my husband to it, we went into hiding in big churches, big numbers. They don't know me. They don't see me. I don't have to do anything. And then there was growing faith. So happy that God led us to growing faith and connected us with these beautiful people, beautiful believers in Christ, who encouraged us in the small things and the big things, letting us know no gift or no effort was too small or, you know, insufficient. Like, everybody plays a role. Everyone as a member of the body of Christ has something to contribute. So, and then part of my testimony and just speaking on behalf of my husband who's out there, just seeing him grow into a thriving relationship with Christ has been the ultimate blessing that we've experienced here, as well as myself, and then seeing our family grow too, helping to add to growing faith with the addition of our baby. So I'm just so thankful, both of us are, to be a part of growing faith for the past 9 years. Love you all.
All right, we got Ms. Darrell's niece.
Hey, y'all. Hey. This is my first time here. Can you hear me? You can hear me? Okay. I'm not a big church person. I'm kind of mostly Buddhist, but I really like this church. I mean, it's the first one. I'm young, so, you know, I fall asleep in church still. You know, it gets me every time, which is why I don't come. But I really like this one, and I want to double back with what Kim was talking about. I'm really big on fostering. Me and my current roommate right now, we're actually trying to work on our co-parenting styles because we're interested in adopting somewhat. So I'm really happy that y'all mentioned that, especially today, because I do want to stay in touch about bringing stuff about that. That's all I really have to say. But I really like it here. This is a great... Thank you.
Thank you. All right, so we have a video we want to cue up in a second, but I like to sum up growing faith in just this phrase. We are imperfect people who love a perfect God who loves us perfectly. That's awesome of growing faith. Amen. Go ahead, Raul, cue the video.
Well, good morning, Growing Faith Fellowship. My name is Tom Allen. I'm the lead pastor of Cross Point Church here in Pearland. And I'm really happy and pleased to be with you today as you celebrate your 9th anniversary. About a year ago, a young man came to me, a good-looking young black man, and said, "Hi, my name's Terrence, and I think you should mentor me." And I thought, I don't know this guy, and I don't have time to mentor people. So I sat down and I had coffee with him, and I said, "Okay, mentoring you, what does that look like? How often? How much time?" And he said, "If you could give me an hour a month, that'd be great." In my mind, I'd already decided an hour a month, that's tops. So we began to meet, and I shared my heart with him. He shared his heart with me. It was a great time. As time went on, I began to look forward to those times together. And pretty shortly into it, he asked me about discipleship materials. And I said, "I've really got some great ones, but we'd need to meet every week." And he said, "That's great." So we began to meet every Thursday. And I have to tell you that during that time, I got to know your pastor. and I got to love your pastor. And not only did I mentor him, but he just brought life and encouragement into me. You have a great pastor, and I just absolutely fell in love with him. In fact, that hour of the week is my favorite hour of the week. I'll be honest with you, that hour usually turns into an hour and a half, even though we swear it won't. I just want to congratulate you on 9 years of building God's kingdom in this city. The city means a lot to me. And therefore, your church means a lot to me. Because you see, when the tide rises, all the ships rise. And I believe we need God to do a great work in this city to reach Pearland for Christ. And if that happens, that means Crosspoint's going to grow and Growing Faith Fellowship is going to grow, and all the churches around us are going to grow. So you need to stay at the wheel and keep going. I look forward to your 18th anniversary and seeing what God has done, because I know your pastor, and I know he's a man of God, and I know he's a man of vision, and I know he loves you with all his heart. So I want to ask you something that maybe he hasn't asked you. I want to ask you to lock arms with him and recommit yourself as you celebrate 9 years of doing ministry in this city. And commit yourself to growing spiritually, individually, and growing as a church, because as more and more people come into this city, more and more people come into the city that don't know Jesus and need a church like you. I've been blessed in my lifetime to have three sons, three great sons. But I told Terrence that I consider him my fourth. And so I just want to say to you, Terrence, son, I love you. I'm proud of you. And I wish you the very, very best. And I'm so grateful for that moment that God brought you into my life. And you said, I think God wants you to mentor me, because you've mentored me as well. God bless you. And church, go with God.
Amen. Wasn't that beautiful? I'm so grateful that God connected me with Pastor Tom, and he truly has been a tremendous blessing to me, and indirectly has been a blessing to you, because a lot of the encouragement that I've received over the last year is because of him. And so, praise God. Oh, amen. All right, so we're just going to, don't want to prolong the time, because I tell you what, I'm so full of expectation and so thankful to be able to be standing here today, 9 years in ministry. Can you give God praise today for that? Praise God. And I'm just grateful. And so don't want to prolong the time, so I do want to thank each of you for being here. So let's take 5 minutes and break, and just enjoy some donuts, unless all the kids eating them all, because I've been seeing those green donuts all around the place. But definitely want to grab you some donuts or coffee or whatever is available. And teachers, who's serving today? I know my beautiful bride is. And Miss Adrian, can you celebrate Adrian and Cindy for serving our children today? But let's take five, and somebody shout it with me, five. Come on, one more time, five. Not seven. Five. Amen. Praise God.
Can you shout it out one more time? I'm expecting great things. I
expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. Great things.
That's real simple right there. Can you help me declare it over your life? Say,
I'm expecting great things. Expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. Great things. In my life, you do great things.
to testing 1 2 testing. Amen. Praise God. Can y'all hear me? Testing 1 2. All right. Testing 1 2. Testing 1 2. If you can turn me up just a little bit, please, sir. All right. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. All right. Pleasant good morning to each of you. Pleasant good morning to those of you joining us online. So grateful that you are here with us today. Praise God. Amen. Is anyone here today expecting great things? Amen. Can you give God some praise right there? Amen. Expecting great things. Praise God. We serve a God who's doing great things. Praise God. Let's take a moment and just lift up the name of Jesus in prayer. Father, we bless your name today. We're so grateful. 9 years, Lord. What a privilege it is to have been able to serve, Lord, your church for 9 years, Lord, and 11 years total pastoring. Lord, I'm humbled today to be, God, one of your many servants, shepherds, under shepherds, Lord. And I pray, God, that you continue to bless me, Lord, bless the people who are serving alongside me in this work, Lord, and bless churches and pastors and ministries all across the country, Lord, who are doing this work and giving of themselves daily. Lord, I pray that you would strengthen our hands. I pray, God, that you help us, Lord, to do and to remain faithful in the call that you have placed upon us, Lord, of leading people searching for more into a thriving relationship with Jesus. Lord, we thank you. Father, we bless you. Thank you, Lord, for all of the children that we get to serve, Lord. Children that we get to minister to. The families, Lord, that you have used us to reach over these years. Lord, for the hundreds of people who have passed through our doors, the countless others that we prayed for and reached unaware, thank you. Now, Lord, I just pray that you would speak through me today. Lord, I realize that your word is essential, and so I pray that you would move me out of the way, and may your word come to the forefront. Lord, I pray that you would bless us as we are here today, God, and we pray for those who are traveling, Lord, for spring break, God. I pray, Lord, that as our children return to school, we pray your protection, your safety upon them all. So, Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O God, our Redeemer. We bless you today, and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Will somebody give God a hand clap of praise today? Amen. He is worthy to be praised. I'm so glad to be here today with you and thankful to be able to celebrate 9 years. Wow. Praise God. Amen. Well, let's get into the word today. Let's see if I can move this screen up a little bit. All right. Okay, so as you know, we started a sermon series last week called Like a Good Neighbor. Pastor Mike did an amazing job. Can you praise God again for that awesome word that he shared with us last week and really laid the groundwork? And if you didn't get the chance to hear that word, I want to encourage you to go back and listen to it, because there's a lot of groundwork that was established that I, for the sake of time, won't go back and talk through, but I do want to encourage us to make sure you go back and check it out. So I'm going to be talking to you today from the idea, the art of neighboring. Can you say that with me? The art of neighboring. Yes, the art of neighboring. So we know that, and Raul, if you could get my timer started, because I want to make sure I am as timely as possible today, because I know some of you want to get those cupcakes. Praise God. Amen. But the art of neighboring. So, you know, we started last week talking about just this idea of neighboring, and it was a sermon that established this idea of being a good neighbor, in essence. You know, we made a statement last week that it was so funny how responsive people were, but the statement was like a good neighbor, right? So, and it's so funny how quickly we just like State Farm is there. And they've done an amazing job at making sure there was a correlation between that phrase, like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. They're masterful at that. And so I got to thinking, what would it be like if when the statement, like a good neighbor, was made, that the first thing that actually came to our minds was being a good neighbor in the context of being a Christ follower? How awesome would that be? And so last week we talked about how the way homes are structured now, where there's no longer a front porch on many homes. There's just pretty much back porches or patios, because we have designed our culture where I don't want to communicate, I don't want to talk with people. I'm going to go into my garage, put it down, you won't see me. I'm going to come out my garage, put it down, you won't see me, you won't talk to me. In fact, it used to be back in the day when the doorbell rang, it was a sense of excitement, like, who's there? I know for me nowadays, when my doorbell rings, I'm like, who is that, right? And I've gotten to the place where I'm high tech. I got it on my phone. Who is? I don't even have to go to the door, right? Because it's almost a disturbance or a disruption for someone to approach my door. The other day, I saw a floor mat in front of the front door that said, "Did you call first?" Right? The reality is that we live in a day and age where neighboring, the message of being a good neighbor, is a really valuable message now, right? Because at the end of the day, Jesus was on to something when he told us to love our neighbor as ourselves. So what we're going to really spend some time on today is this idea of how do I love my neighbor. I don't want to spend a whole lot of time here, but let me just tell you that for me, I have seen the impact of what good neighboring can look like. I've also seen the opposite of what poor neighboring can look like. I personally witnessed it and experienced it. Short story, I was coming home one day, and as I had my music going and I had my windows down, and you know, I might have been jamming Lecrae or The Truth or somebody like that. Amen. And so, boy, my music was bumping. And when I came around the corner, I heard commotion. And it was a lot of commotion, a lot of commotion. And I was thinking to myself as I heard the commotion, oh, it's a block party. It's a party going on. Well, it was not. It was actually two neighbors that were feuding. And they were really getting it. They were like, I mean, a lot of gestures and a lot of words that will remain unrepeated, right? It was a lot of just energy, that the kind of energy that it was the kind of energy that make you do this. None of my business, right? Anybody know about that? That kind of, it's like exit stage left, right? I'm not going to even get into that. That's none of my business. Y'all handle it. Well, I parked my car, and I heard the commotion, and I saw the gestures, and my thought was to go in my house. And as I got ready to walk up the driveway, the Spirit said to me, "You mean to tell me you're going to walk away from an opportunity to intervene?" And in my mind, I'm like, "Lord, I have seen it. I could see the news report now. Local pastor." You know, they always start with that, right? Local pastor attempts to intervene in a dispute and loses his life, right? And here's the truth. I can't even get into all of the barriers that exist when we think about what does it require for me to be a good neighbor. I can't even get into it. But one of the biggest, greatest barriers is fear. It's a fear of, it's all kinds of fear. Fear of being a someone getting in other people's business. Fear of people getting into your business. Fear of just being involved that could disrupt your life, whatever the case may be. So as I decided I was going to walk in the house and ignore that, and that's none of my business, the Spirit prompted me, and so I went over, and I called myself trying to intervene and all of that. But the thing that I wanted to share with you is that I have been impacted by what does it look like to be a bad neighbor. And I've also been impacted by what does it look like to be a good neighbor. Because around the same time, my mother had a health crisis. And this health crisis shook us all. We were completely taken aback. It was something that we were totally not expecting. And a good neighbor, Sister Crystal, she is a nurse, and she was able to come over and get into our business. And I want you to know, being a good neighbor, the impact of being a good neighbor is greater than what we truly can understand. I believe that being a good neighbor actually is the secret weapon for the church to advance the kingdom agenda. So it is with that introduction that I want to paint a picture. This is called the art of neighboring. So for those of you who don't know, I didn't perceive myself to be very intelligent, and so I really had no desire or interest to go to college. And on top of all of that, my mom decided she was going to enroll me in college, right? She was just like, you're going to go to college. And I was like, but I just met this young tenderoni called Cindy, and so I just didn't have no dreams or aspirations for college. And so, but my mom enrolled me in school, and she said, but there's one thing, Terrence, you can do. You could do art. And I said, who goes to college to get an art degree? But that's what I could do, and that's what I did. And so in school, one of the things that I discovered, one of my passions, is I love to work with all types of what they call mediums. And like whether it was acrylic paint or oil paint or watercolor, which was one of my favorite. The idea is that you had to take the paint and you had to put it on a canvas. In other words, the paint was no good unless you had a canvas. They went hand in hand. Is that making sense? What we're going to find in the text today is that Jesus is going to teach us that loving God means nothing if you don't also love your neighbor. Yeah. Yeah. That you can't have a love for me and not have a love for your neighbor. Woo, boy, if I could just preach today, y'all. Come on. I don't have a whole lot of time here, but let me just get into the text real quick. So in Mark 12, what we see is Jesus is getting ready to teach someone something because they had a question. And many times the Pharisees and the Sadducees were coming to ask Jesus a question, but they had no intention of learning. You know, it's very hard to teach someone who doesn't want to learn something. It's two things my daddy used to say you can't give somebody: something that you don't have and something they don't want. Come on. So, but there was a man probably a scribe, which probably was a Pharisee, who did, in fact, have a question. And his question was, good teacher, master, Jesus, what is the most important commandment? Notice what the text says. And one of the scribes came up and heard them disputing with one another, and seeing that he answered them well, asked him, which commandment is the most important? Somebody shout, most important. Most important. Yeah, if you're online, type in the chat, most important. Of what? Of all. Jesus answered, the most important is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with. Do you think Jesus is trying to make a point? He's most certainly trying to make a point. See, I find that it's real easy for me to love God casually, to give him what I have left. And if you're anything like me, at the end of the day, it's not much. Y'all, Gabe went and spent some time with his, he has a younger brother that lives in Dickinson. And so, you know, as a loving father, I said, well, son, I will allow you to go and spend some time with the family. And I missed the little guy, actually. But, boy, for those first few days, I was like, man, thank you, Lord. I was just a little freedom. You know, just I was able to sleep a little longer and, you know, eat in peace and not watch some random cartoons. Praise God. And so, but here's the thing that I'm discovering about being a parent. Y'all have to excuse me. I know I'm 47 years old, but I'm just learning this, Marcia. Man, children require a lot of energy. They really do. They don't care what you done had going on. It don't matter. I don't care that you've been at work today. It's about me. I'm ready to go play. And when I come back inside, what we going to eat? And what we going to do? And after I get done, a few hours later, I'm hungry again. This brother has the nerve to stay up late and come talk about at 12 midnight. I'm hungry. Man, go to bed. I digress. But, man, I just realized that it's requiring all that I have. And God has ministered to me. He says, Terrence, being a father is not much different than being a son. I want all. I don't want a portion. I want all of you. And so Jesus is telling us here in the scripture, which is what's called, this is the Shema. This is the prayer in Judaism that Jews pray daily. And so I imagine it was no secret when this man said, what's the most important commandment, that he, Jesus, said it was this prayer. But what I found really intriguing is that Jesus gave this man extra information. He said, the second is this. Now, hold on, Jesus. I didn't ask you for that. I said, what's the most important, most indicating one? But Jesus doesn't stop there. He says, and the second is this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. What Jesus was saying is that you can't have the paint without the canvas. You can't have the peanut butter without the jelly. You can't have a key without a lock. In other words, if you are going to love me, you are required to love your neighbor. So this is where I basically want us to spend a little time. I won't be before you long, but this is where I want to talk through. Why is loving my neighbor as myself key to Christianity? Why? Why? And I want to just want to go on record and just say, I want to repent before you. We value brave transparency, and I believe transparency is powerful because it helps us to see one another and to be able to then pray for one another. I have had an issue with the love of God. I've had an issue with it. And the issue that I've had with God's love is what I've seen the world do with it. I've seen the world make statements like, if you loved me, then you would accept me. And the truth of the matter is that you can love somebody and not accept their behavior. Right? I literally, I'm at a place, and y'all gonna hear me talk a lot about Gabe over the next, I don't know, but I'm just becoming a dad, and it's like, it's this thing that's happening with me, and I knew that it would happen. You know, I was expecting it, but I didn't realize it would be so frequent. But the Lord just showed me, he said, Terrence, he said, do you love Gabe? I said, man, I do. I love this kid. I can only imagine what it would be like for you to have a child within you, not me. No desire, no. I digress, but. But mothers. Can only imagine what it would be like for you to carry a child for almost 10 months, is it? 40 weeks? She like, say it! Testify! I can only imagine the kind of love and bond that's created in that process. And then to see that sweet face looking up at you and just, oh, my baby. I can only imagine. I can see why parents can be super defensive when it comes to their children. I can see why my mom would say, I will scratch your face off and eat it for breakfast. I added that part. I can see, right? The love, but the love, though, is just, in the early stages, just one way. You looking down at them, and they just so cute. They looking up at you like, where my food at? Change my diaper. There is no reciprocal love. And even as they get older, right, they're 5 years old, and it's still about them, and 10, and then they become teenagers, and they know everything, and I hate you, and oh, no, I know you didn't. Man, I just could only imagine. But at some point, something happens to where it goes from just being one way to being reciprocated. And it's amazing because I look back on how my parents loved me, and I could see it, and I could appreciate it so much greater. And so God started ministering to me about his love. And he said, Terrence, I don't think that you truly remember and relish and bask in the truth of my love for you. No, I don't like some of your ways. Yes, I will correct you. In fact, the Father chastises those that he loves. It is an expression, an extension of my love to correct you. I love you, and I will not accept your behavior. That's love for me, because I haven't really just internalized God's love in a while. It did take me back for a moment to remind me the Father loves me. And I want you for a moment. Can we do this? Can you do this with me? Can you just say, Jesus loves me?
Loves me.
If you're online, come on, Jesus loves me. Come on, one more time, Jesus loves me. Yeah, we're getting ready to celebrate in a few weeks the love that Jesus demonstrated by laying his life down. And I think sometimes we struggle with understanding God's love because we think, well, if you loved me, then you would do this. God, if you loved me, really, really loved me, why am I experiencing this? Have you ever said that? God, if you really love me, why am I struggling with this situation? If you really love me, why am I dealing? Why did they abandon me if you really love me? Why? See, it's because we truly struggle with understanding the love of God. It was Paul who said three times, I prayed, God, remove this thorn from my flesh, this thing that's in me, remove it. And you know what Jesus responded? No. My grace is sufficient. My strength is perfected in your weakness. So maybe you're at a place right now. Can I minister for a moment? Maybe you're at a place right now where you have questioned God's love for you solely based on your situation. Well, can I dispel the myth? You are loved. You are loved. You are loved. You ought to say that I am loved. I don't know what you're experiencing right now, but I need you to know that you are loved. Why? Because that is a centered truth that you must always rehearse. You must always rehearse that I am loved. Yes, I know what you did last night. I still love you. Yes, I know what you said, but I still love you. As I was rehearsing in my heart what it looks like for me to love Gabriel, this is a kid who was snatched out of everything familiar. Relocated to a strange place. And one of the things that they shared with us is that he struggles to attach. And it's because he's trying to figure out, what is this life? And God began to minister to me. He said, you know what, Terrence? You know what I need you to do? All I need for you to do is love. And he may not even respond to it. So the other night, we pray every night, and you know, we kneel down and we pray together. And as I'm walking out of the room, leading up to this, I've made sure he gets something to eat. That's love, isn't it? I'm talking about where my birthday present at. Do you feel the AC? It's all around. Come on. Did you see those clothes you had on? Boy, that's love. I've been showing him love. This 4 weeks that he's been in our home, I've been showing him love. But then, after we prayed, I said, I love you. And he kind of hesitated, and like many men do when another man tells you they love you. Did you catch it? Because sometimes it's hard to know that you are loved. It's even harder for you to then extended. So when we look at this question, why is loving my neighbor as myself key to Christianity? Can I tell you what makes it key? How else will people who are far from God know that they are loved? Is God coming down and doing something for them to show them? He actually uses us to do it. See, I like the way it said it in 1 John 4. It says, we love, why? Because he first loved us. Here's the message. Here's the message. We love because he first loved us. So you see, when the man asked Jesus, what's the greatest commandment? Jesus' response, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart. Jesus is drawing attention to this truth. When you know, James, that you are loved, there is only one response. Can I tell you what that one response is? It's to love back. It's the only response that makes sense. See, we love because he first. See, being a good neighbor will be a hard task because you're having to show love to people who don't love you back. I believe... in the context of romantic love, that Teddy P made sense. I told myself I wasn't going to sing it, but I'm going to sing it. It's so good loving somebody when somebody loves you back, and that's fact. It's good to love when somebody loves you back. Boy, that's a good kind of love, isn't it? I love you, Brother Darryl, and guess what? Brother Darryl loves me. Man, that's good. But it's a whole nother thing when I love you and you don't love me back. Because can I be real with you? Hate me, and I hate you back. It's a whole lot more fun. Oh, I'm going to match your in. Oh, really? Okay, I got one better for you. Right? You started it. I'm going to finish it. Huh? Yes. Look, you call me out my name, I'm going to talk about your mama. Now what? Right? But the reality is that Jesus teaches us, no, that's not how love works. Right. Because I have loved you, I'm calling you to love others. Can I tell you a secret? This is a secret weapon. It's powerful. In Romans 12, it says in verse 18, don't be overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. Yeah. The scripture goes on to say, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. You know what happens when we minister love to those who are unlovable? You know what happens? We are demonstrating the way we have been loved. Because let's just be real. Have you really been worthy of the love that Jesus has given to you? Have you really? Did you pray the way you should have? Did you fast the way you should have? Did you give the way you should have? Did you live the way you should have? No! But that's grace. I was cleaning up Gabe's spot on the table because, you know, we let him have his own little spot at the table because he just, boy, it's just dirty. And I'm just looking like, come on, man. Why you just can't eat on your plate and let the crumbs fall on the plate? I just don't understand. And then when you get up from the table, just put it in the trash, right? It's simple. It kind of feels like some of the things my wife be telling me, but that's beside the point. Never mind that. But I realized that I love Gabriel not because of the things that he does. I love him because I am loved. That's the only response that I have. So it says, if anyone says, I love God. Oh, how many times have I said, we sing songs about it. I love you, Lord. Oh, man. I love the Lord. I love God. I love the Lord. But, and hate his brother, he's a liar. What God is saying is that you got a key with no lock. Have you ever gone through your keys and looked and be like, what is this key for? It's worthless. God says, if you say that you love me, but you hate your brother, you actually don't. And here's what I always like to say. If you realize that you are not where you're supposed to be, that's okay. It is okay for you to discover that I say that I love God, but are there people in your life right now that you can just say without even hesitating, I hate that person? You don't have to answer, but here's the reality. I know all of us may have somebody that you just like, oh boy, I hate them. My mom told me, she said, T, pray with me that I don't hate Donald Trump. I said, pray, I just don't like what he's doing to our country. I said, Mama, let me tell you something. Let me bless you. Let me bless you. That brother ain't thinking about you. And it's funny how here we are, we're hating people that's not even thinking about us. They didn't went on with their life. They laughing and living, and you the one struggling because you're holding on to something that they said or did to you. When in reality, I don't have time to hate you because I'm so busy being loved by God. What I can do is I can pray for you. So here, we're being called out. And it's okay that you're not here. It is okay that if right now, you cannot say that you love God and you love your brother. By the way, in terms of loving your brother, it means you're anyone. I like the way Mike put it last week. Earth is a neighborhood. It's God's neighborhood. And so not only is it a literal neighbor, the person that I am near, but anyone that's a part of the human race. So we see, you might not be here, but what I always like to say, it's okay. You just can't stay there. Where you realize Jesus said it this way. He said, if you're at the altar bring in a sacrifice. And there, realize that you have aught against a brother. Jesus said, leave your offering here. Go to that brother and get it right. Is that hard? Certainly it is. See, God never asks us to do something that we can do in and of our own strength. Never. Otherwise, what do you need faith for? Otherwise, why do you need to trust him? See, maybe at this moment in your heart, you're thinking about that neighbor that you're not loving the way you have been loved. That's okay. This is hard. So now I'm saying, God, help me to do what you're asking me to do. Notice what he says. He says, for he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must also love his brother. Here's what I'm getting at today, family. What I'm saying, very simply, when Jesus was asked, what's the greatest commandment? He said, love the Lord with everything you have and love your neighbor as you love yourself. And the way that we do that is we remember that we have first been loved. So here's what I want to encourage us to do. I want you daily to reflect on the love that God has for you. I want you to take time and see what are the ways that God has shown his love towards me. How has he loved me the way he has? What are the ways that God loves me? Think about how unworthy of that love you are, yet and still he loves you. And out of that space, love others. The next thing I want to encourage you to do, on a literal note, love those that are near you, your neighbor. Literally, if you live in a neighborhood, I want to ask you to do something. Or if you live in an apartment complex, I want you to do this. I want you to create like a grid. And on this grid, I want you to identify the houses or the apartments that are near you. And I want you to get an image of that. And I want you to consider, what are their names? Do you know their names? What do you know about them? Here's a great opportunity. Let's say there's a neighbor that is across the way from you. You've never met them. You wave at them. Here's a great way to connect with them. Hey, I see you all the time. I wave at you all the time. My name is, and introduce yourself. And then when you go inside, write their name down. Here's the next step. Just begin to pray. Just pray for them. You know, God did something really beautiful for us last couple of years where he's connected us to our neighbors. But the Lord really convicted me the other day. He said, Terrence, what about the neighbors that are hard to love? How have you pursued them? And the way that you have been loved, you know how you have been loved? You've been pursued. I've pursued you. It could be that the neighbors that are hard to love, that just seem like neighbors that are like, man, this person is like a real piece of work, which is the way I like to put it. Man, that brother is a piece of work. Maybe you are in that community for that very purpose. Because you have been loved so profoundly that out of that same love, we should love one another. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the many ways that you have loved us. Lord, we realize that loving our neighbor is a central tenet of our faith. God, because you want us to love other people the way we have been loved, because your word teaches us that herein shall they know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. Lord, we recognize that love is the answer. So, Lord, help us to love the unlovable. God, help us to serve. Help us to minister. Help us, God, to pour out the love lavishly received. Forgive us, God, for those times that we haven't been neighborly, those times when we've tried to live in silos or isolated, separated from community. And Lord, remind us that the greatest love of all that has been demonstrated is the way Jesus loved us, gave himself selflessly for us. Lord, help us to love our neighbor as ourselves. Now, Lord, if there's one here today or one that's watching online who needs to make Jesus Lord of their lives, I pray, Lord, that they would surrender and give their lives to you right now. In fact, if you're here today, if you're online, I want you to pray this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know without you, I am lost. Forgive me for my sins. Come into my heart. I make you my Lord and my Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Now fill me with your Spirit that I may have the power to live for you. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, we want to invite you to reach out, connect with us, because we believe in the power of prayer, and we believe in getting to know the Lord on a deeper level. Well, family, would you stand on your feet this morning?